Beacon Press Audio presents Mothercoin, The Stories of Immigrant Nannies by Elizabeth Cummins Muñoz. This audiobook is narrated by Frankie Corzo, published by Beacon Press Audio 2022. Introduction. Park Benches. What is a mother worth? Lafayette Park is a small playground tucked into a corner of a Houston neighborhood known for its family-friendly spaces and two-story stucco and brick homes. In the center, an oak tree stretches its branches over the play equipment, an old swing set, a sandbox bordered by stacked wooden logs, a playhouse with stairs worn concave by years of sneakers and sandals and bare feet climbing each rung. The live oak hovers over the place. Older than the climbing ladder or the squeaky swings or the quiet city street beside it, it is a protective presence shielding children from the suffocating heat of a Houston summer or the cold wind of a January afternoon. An old iron bench in the shape of a square surrounds the thickest part of the tree's trunk so that a tired caregiver, weary of the heat and the sun or the work of the day, might lean back against the oak's rough bark and watch the children play. On a cool January afternoon several years ago, I took a place on this bench next to a woman I call Sarah, and I asked her to tell me about her life. At 25, Sarah carries her years heavy on her shoulders. As children in El Salvador, she and her younger sisters watched their mother leave to migrate north for work in the private homes of Texas. At 14, she herself left her village and schooling and girlhood behind to follow the same path. For over a decade, she has cleaned the homes of this city, looked after its little ones, walked its dogs. She has missed her own children's school celebrations and after-school homework sessions, and spent long summer days chasing after flushed blonde cheeks and picking up shorts and bathing suits from bathroom floors, while her own children waited for her in the care of others, a distracted neighbor, an ambivalent aunt. Sarah has bought a house and sent her children to good schools. She has supported her grandparents and younger sister back home for years. And she has asked herself if her mother's choice was the right one. She doesn't think so. There's been so much pain. But then, the house, the education, the hope. After about 2 hours of conversation, my children and hers begin to whine and call for us. Cheeks chapped, cold burrowing in beneath unzipped jackets and discarded sweaters as the sun falls behind a line of wild ligustrum. Sarah's son and daughter climb into an old SUV, mine into a worn minivan, and we each go back to our homes and our dishes and our bills and our laundry, and to the hopes and fears and uncertainties that will carry us into the night. For me, one question eclipses the others. How much is a mother worth? There are deep and complicated truths at the heart of this question. Some of these have to do with the distance between what a society says about its mothers and how it treats them. Others have to do with the way a culture teaches its children that value is dispersed differently among its various groups, the privileged and the poor, the fair and the dark, the masculine and the feminine, and how those children grow to reproduce the same cultural value system. And some part of the truth of a mother's worth lies deep in her own chest, in the place where a society's words and actions and a culture's value lessons meet the truths she alone has come to know. At this meeting place of world and woman, a sense of self emerges. Though I did not know it at the time, when I invited Sarah to tell me about her life that day in Lafayette Park, the story she told expressed her own sense of self. Sarah's narrative painted the portrait of a woman conflicted, weary, proud, and overwhelmed by the limits placed on all her good intentions as a caring nanny, a selfless mother, and a dignified worker. It has been over a decade since I began asking women like Sarah for their stories. I've heard many and read many more, each as unique as the woman who told it, yet all of them bound up in the complicated question of value as it pertains to motherhood, domestic work, and the ideological minefields of immigration policy. Despite the women's individual differences, the stories they tell reveal common themes. All must choose among limited options and carry the burden of choice alone. As they live out the consequences of their choices, they all encounter the public lessons that dark-skinned women learn about whose needs come first, and that immigrants learn about the power of status to deny basic humanity. And within the private space of homes like the two-story stuccos that surround Lafayette Park, each woman must negotiate culture and language and intimacy and livelihood in the shadows of an unregulated industry defined by the unique vulnerabilities of paid care work. Together, these common themes tell the story of immigrant nannies in this country. The Mothercoin. Women like Sarah and her mother are part of a broad phenomenon of international migration for domestic and care work that has been growing since the end of the last century. Spurred by widening global inequality and an increased demand for domestic service in the North. As cleaners and caregivers move from poorer regions into wealthier ones, they leave behind a material and emotional absence that is keenly felt by their families in the global South. North of these borders, children of wealthier regions are bathed and diapered and cared for in clean homes with folded laundry and sopa de arroz simmering on the stove, while their parents work even longer hours and often struggle with these daily separations. Somewhere in between, women like those featured here fashion a life at the crossroads of globalization, immigration, and the judgments we make about good mothers who stay home and bad mothers who leave. The Mothercoin has something to do with these judgments. When love is elevated and labor is compensated, mothering for pay becomes a complicated proposition. Because even as the work of mothering has become valuable currency in the shadow economy of a largely invisible industry, for these women and those who employ them, the cultural ideal of motherhood remains rooted in loving presence and divorced from economic self-interest. In our popular imagination, mothers are somehow always present, loving tirelessly, sacrificing constantly, protecting fiercely, and making the work of housekeeping and family nourishment as neat and invisible as the pressed sheets of a freshly made bed. The role of the immigrant nanny is to facilitate this ideal, but it comes at a cost. The choices she makes are limited by the realities she encounters. Regional inequity exacerbated by globalism and the neoliberal policies meant to manage it. Labyrinthine immigration practices that refuse to account for the reality of the female underside of globalization and maternity and childcare policies in the U.S. that willfully ignore the social and economic value of child rearing. Fed by the ideological rhetoric of immigration and women's work, these broken systems are patched together by a steady stream of migrant women who are told they are responsible for the choices they make, for the desperation that pushes them north, the children whose needs they cannot meet, and the emotional entanglements that compromise their service. The Mothercoin inflicts a real moral harm when it frames the inevitable conflicts it creates as the result of a personal choice. To make a woman believe it is somehow in her power to protect herself and the children she loves from the pain of her limited options, if only she were good enough to choose differently. It took me a long time to understand that the deepest injustice of the Mothercoin lies in the threat it poses to a woman's sense of herself. Many years of research and interviews, reading and reflecting, and finally learning to hear the stories the women were telling. Beside the Sandbox. I didn't set out to write this book. In the beginning, it was only conversations on a weekday morning playground. I would arrive with my young children in a stroller or on a trike, diaper bag or picnic basket in hand, and set up on a park bench beside the sandbox. My oldest two took after their father, and when I reached for them, the contrast of their chestnut hair and dark skin, wrapped up in my fair arms, must have been striking to the nannies who watched us. Though a native Houstonian of European ancestry, I'd studied Spanish for years, and I spoke it fluently and always to the children. It would have been hard for the nannies in the park not to wonder about us, the Americana on the playground speaking Spanish to Hispanic-looking children. Hard not to glance furtively as I lifted one child into a bucket swing and offered the other a shovel, or to resist the impulse to move a bit closer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.